When shall we three meet again? In thunder, lightning, or in rain?
When the hurly-burly is done. When the battle's lost and won.
That will be ere the set of sun.
Where are the priests?
Upon the heath.
There, to meet with Macbeth.
Fair is foul. And foul is fair.
Hover through the fog and filthy air.
And fair a day I have not seen.
How far is it called to Forest?
What are these? So withered and so wild in their attire that look not like the inhabitants of the earth, and yet they're on it. Live you? Or are you aught that man may question? You seem to understand me. By each at once her choppy finger laying upon her skinny lips. You should be women, yet your beards forbid me to interpret that you are so.
Speak if you can. What are you?
All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Glamis. All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Cornwall.
All hail, Macbeth, that shall be king hereafter.
Good sir, why do you start and seem to fear things that do sound so fair? In the name of truth, are ye fantastical? Or that indeed which outwardly you show. My noble partner, you greet with present grace and great prediction of noble having and of royal hope, that he seems wrapped withal. To me you speak not. If you can look into the seeds of time and see which grain will grow and which will not, speak then to me, who neither beg nor fear your favors nor your hate.
Hail. Hail.
Hail.
Lesser than Macbeth. And greater.
Not so happy, yet much happier.
Thou shalt get kings, though thou be none. So all hail Macbeth and Banquo.
Banquo?
Stay! You imperfect speakers. Tell me more. By Cynel's death, I know I'm Thane of Glamis. But how of Cawdor? Thane of Cawdor lives, prosperous gentleman. And to be king stands not in the prospect of belief, no more than to be Cawdor. Say from whence you owe this strange intelligence, or why upon this blasted heath you stop our way with such prophetic greetings. Speak. I charge you.
The earth hath bubbles as the water has, and these are of them. Whither have they vanished?
Into the air. And what seemed corporal melted. As breath on the wind. Would they had stayed.
Were such things here as we do speak about? Or have we eaten on the insane route that takes the reason prisoner?
Your children shall be kings.
You shall be king.
And Thane of Cawdor too, and it not so?
To the selfsame tune and words.
They met me in the day of success, and I have learned by the perfectest report they have more in them than mortal knowledge. When I burned in desire to question them further, they made themselves air, into which they vanished. Whilst I stood wrapped in the wonder of it, came a message from the king who all hailed me Thane of Cawdor.
For it is thine.
Which title before these weird sisters saluted me and referred me to the coming on of time with hail king that shall be.
What can the devil speak through?
This have I thought good to deliver thee, my dearest partner of greatness, that thou mayst not lose the dues of rejoicing by being ignorant of what greatness is promised thee. Lay it to thy heart and farewell.
Glamis thou art. And Cawdor, and shalt be what thou art promised. Yet do I fear thy nature. 'Tis too full of the milk of human kindness to catch the nearest way. Thou wouldst be great, or not without ambition, but without the illness should attend it. What thou wouldst highly, that wouldst thou holily. Wouldst not play false. And yet wouldst wrongly win. Thou'dst have great glams, that which cries, thus must thou do if thou have it. And that which rather thou dost fear to do, than wish should be undone. Dies with the valor of my tongue all that impedes thee from the golden round, which fate and metaphysical aid doth seem to have thee crowned withal. What? Is your tidings?
The king comes here tonight.
Thou art mad to say it. Is not thy master with him, who, were it so, would have informed for preparation?
So please you, it is true. Our Thane is coming. One of my fellows had the speed of him, who, almost dead for breath, had scarcely more than would make up his message.
Give him tending.
He brings great news. The raven himself is hoarse. The croaks the fatal entrance of Duncan. Come, you spirits that tend on mortal thoughts. Unsex me here, and fill me from the crown to the toe, top full of direst cruelty. Make thick my blood, stop up that access and passage to remorse, that no compunctious visitings of nature
shake my fell purpose, nor keep peace between the effect and it. Come to my woman's breasts and take my milk for gall, you murdering ministers, wherever in your sightless substances you wait on nature's mischief. Come, thick night, and pull thee in the dunnest smoke of hell, that my keen knife see not the wound it makes, nor heaven peep through the blanket of the dark to cry, hold, hold. Great Glams. Worthy Coder. Greater than both by the all hail hereafter. Thy letters have transported me beyond this ignorant present, and I feel now the future in the instant.
My dearest love, Duncan comes here tonight.
And when goes hence?
Tomorrow, as he purposes.
Oh, never shall sun that morrow see. Your face, my fame, is as a book where men may read strange matters. To beguile the time, look like the time. Bear welcome in your eye, your hand, your tongue. Look like the innocent flower. Be the serpent under it. He that's coming must be provided for, and you shall put this night's great business into my dispatch, which shall, for all our nights and days to come, give solely sovereign sway and masterdom.
We will speak further.
Only look up clear. To alter favor ever is to fear.
Castle hath a pleasant seat. The air nimbly and sweetly recommends itself unto our gentle senses.
This guest of summer, a temple-haunting martlet, doth approve by his loved masonry that the heaven's breath smells wooingly here. No jutty, frieze, buttress, nor coign of vantage, but this bird hath made his pendant bed and procreant cradle. Where they most breed and haunt, I have observed. The air is delicate.
Honored hostess, the love which follows us sometimes is our trouble, which still we thank as love. Herein I teach you how you shall bid God Ildis for your pains and thank us for your trouble. Where's the Thane of Cawdor? We cost him at the heels and have a purpose to be his purveyor. But he rides well, and his great love, sharp as his spur, hath hope him to his home before us. Pray, and noble hostess, We are your guest tonight.
Oh, your servants ever have theirs, themselves, and what is theirs in compt, to make their audit at your highness's pleasure, still to return your own.
Give me your hand. Conduct me to mine host. We love him highly, and shall continue our graces towards him. By your leave, hostess. No, we will establish our estate upon our eldest, Malcolm.
That now Swain of the Norway's king craves composition. Nor will we deign a burial of his men till he dispersed at St. Combs Inch. 10,000.
If it were done, when 'tis done, then 'twere well it were done quickly. If the assassination could trammel up the consequence and catch with his surcease success, that but this blow might be the be-all and the end-all. Here, but here, upon this bank and shawl of time, we jump the life to come. But in these cases, we still have judgment here, that we but teach bloody instruction, which, being taught, return to plague the inventor. This even-handed justice commends the ingredients of our poisoned chalice to our own lips. He's here, in double trust. First, as I am his kingsman and his subject, strong both against the deed. Then, as his host, who should against his murderer shut the door, not bear the knife myself. Besides, this Duncan hath borne his faculty so meek, hath been so clear in his great office, that his virtues will plead like angels, trumpet-tongued against the deep damnation of his taking off. And pity, like a naked newborn babe striding the blast, or heaven's cherubim horsed upon the sightless couriers of the air, shall blow the horrid deed in every eye, that tears shall drown the wind. I have no spur to prick the sides of my intent, but only vaulting ambition, which o'erleaps itself and falls on the other.
There, if I grow, the harvest is your own.
My plenteous joys. What a littleness seek to hide themselves in drops of sorrow.
And to conclude, the victory fell on us.
Oh, no? What news?
He hath almost supped. Why have you left the chamber?
Had he asked for me?
No, you're not, he has.
We will proceed no further in this business. He hath honored me of late, and I bought golden opinions from all sorts of people, which would be borne now in its newest gloss. Not cast aside so soon.
Was the hope drunk wherein you jest yourself? Have it slept since? And waits it now to look so green and pale on what it did so freely? From this time, such I account thy love. Art thou afeared to be the same in thine own act and valor as thou art in desire? Wouldst thou have that which thou esteemst the ornament of life and live a coward in thine own esteem, letting I dare not wait upon I would, like the poor cat in the adage?
Prithee, peace. I dare do all that may become a man. Who dares more is none.
What peace was then that made you break this enterprise to me? When you durst do it, then you were a man. And to be more than what you were, you would be so much more than man. Nor time, nor place did then adhere, yet you would make both.
will they have made themselves, but that their fitness now does unmake you.
I have given suck, and know how tender 'tis to love the babe that milks me. I would, while it was smiling in my face, have plucked my nipple from his boneless gums and dashed the brains out. Had I so sworn as you have done to this?
If we should fail.
We fail. But screw your courage to the sticking place. And we'll not fail. When Duncan is asleep, whereto the rather shall his day's hard journey soundly invite him, his two chamberlains will I with wine and wassail so convince that memory, the water of the brain, shall be a fume, and the receipt of reason a limbic only. When in swinish sleep their drenched natures lies as in a death, what cannot you and I perform upon the unguarded Duncan? What not put upon his spongy officers, who shall bear the guilt of our great quell?
Bring forth men, children only. For thy undaunted metal should compose nothing but males.
Will it not be received when we have marked with blood those sleepy two of his own chamber, and used their very daggers that they have dunned?
Who dares receive it other? For we shall make our griefs and clamor roar upon his death.
I am settled, and bend up each corporal agent to this terrible feat. Away, and mock the time with fairest show. The false face must hide what the false heart doth know.
How goes the night, boy?
The moon is down. I've not heard the clock.
And she goes down at 12.
I take it is later, sir.
Hold. Take my sword. Does husband dream heaven? Their candles are all out. Take thee that, too. A heavy summons lies like lead upon me. And yet I would not sleep. As if a power's restraining me, the cursed thoughts that nature gives way to in repose. Give me my sword. Who's here?
A friend.
What, sir? Not yet at rest. The king's abed. He hath been an unusual pleasure, and sent forth great largesse to your offices. This diamond he greets your wife withal, by the name of most kind hostess, and shut up in measureless content.
Being unprepared, our will became a servant to defect, which else should free have wrought.
All's well. I dreamt last night of the three weird sisters. To you they showed some truth?
I think not of them. Yet, when we can entreat an hour to serve, we would spend it in some words upon that business, if you'd grant the time.
At your kindest leisure.
If you shall cleave to my consent, when 'tis, it shall make honor for you.
So I lose none in seeking to augment it, but keep my bosom franchised and allegiance clear. I shall be counseled.
Good repose the while.
Thanks, sir. Like to hear.
will be thy mistress when my drink is ready. She strike upon the bell. Get thee to bed. Clutch thee. I have thee not, and yet I see thee still. Art thou not fatal vision, sensible to feeling as to sight? Or art thou but a dagger of the mind, a false creation proceeding from the heat-oppressed brain? I see thee yet, in form as palpable as this which now I draw. Thou marshals me the way that I was going, and such an instrument I was to use. Mine eyes are made the fools of the other senses, or else worth all the rest. I see thee still, and on thy blade and dudgeon gouts of blood which was not so before. There's no such thing. It is the bloody business which informs us to mine eyes. Now o'er the one half world nature seems dead, and wicked dreams abuse the curtain sleep. Witchcraft celebrates pale Hecate's offerings, and withered murder, alarmed by his sentinel, the wolf, whose howls his watch, thus with his stealthy pace, with Tarquin's ravishing strides towards his design, moves like a ghost. Thou sure and firm-set earth, hear not my steps, which way they walk, for fear thy very stones prate of my whereabout, and take the present horror from the time which now suits with it. Whilst I threat, he lives. Words to the heat of deeds too cold breath gives. I go. Is done. The bell invites me. Hear it not, Duncan, for it is a knell that summons thee to heaven or to hell.
That which hath made them drunk hath made me bold. What hath quenched them hath given me fire. It was the owl that screeched. The fatal bellman, which gives the sterns good night. He is about it. The doors are open, and the surfeited grooms do mock their charge with snores.
Sleep no more.
Alack. I'm afeard they have awaked and 'tis not done. The attempt and not the deed confounds us. Hark. Oh, I laid their daggers ready. He could not miss them. Had he not resembled my father as he slept, I had done it. My husband?
I've done the deed. Didst thou not hear a noise?
Oh, I heard the owl scream and the crickets cry. Did not you speak?
When?
Now.
As I descended?
Aye.
Hark! Who lies in the second chamber?
Donalbain.
This is a sorry sight.
Foolish thought to see a sorry sight.
There's one did laugh in his sleep, and one cried madder, that they wake each other. I stood and heard them, but they did say their prayers, and addressed them again to sleep.
There are two lodged together.
This one cried, God bless us. Amen, the other, that they had seen me with these hangman's hands. Listening their fear, I could not say amen when they did say God bless us.
Consider it not so deeply.
But wherefore could I not say amen? I had most need of blessing, and amen stuck in my throat.
These deeds must not be thought after these ways. So it will make us mad.
Methought I heard a voice cry, sleep no more. Macbeth hath murdered sleep. The innocent sleep. Sleep that knits up the ruffled sleeve of care, the death of each day's life, sore labor's bath, balm of hard minds, great nature's second course, chief nourisher in life's feast.
What do you mean?
And still it cried, sleep no more. Glams hath murdered sleep, and therefore Cotto shall sleep no more, Macbeth shall sleep no more.
Who was it that thus cried, huh? Why, worthy thing, you do unbend your manly strength to think so brain-sickly of things. Go, get some water, and wash this filthy witness from your hands. Why did you bring the daggers from the place? They must lie there. Go, carry them, and smear the sleepy grooms with blood.
I'll go no more. I'm afraid to think what I have done, to look alt again. I dare not.
Infirm of purpose. Oh, give me the daggers. The sleeping and the dead are but as pictures. 'Tis the eye of childhood that fears a painted devil. If he do bleed, I'll gild the faces of the grooms withal, for it must seem their guilt.
Will all great Neptune's ocean wash this blood clean from my hand? No. This my hand would rather the multitudinous seas incarnadine, making the green one red.
My hands are of your colour, yet I shiver to wear a heart. heart so white. Well, I hear a knocking at the south entry. Retire we to our chamber? Little water clears us off the steed. How easy is it then? Your constancy hath left you unattended. Hark, more knocking! Get on your nightgown, lest occasion call us and show us to be watchers. Be not lost so poorly in your thoughts.
To know my deed, 'twere best not know myself.
Wake Duncan with thy knocking!
I would thou couldst.
So late?
Feed, sir. We were carousing till the second cock. And drink, sir, is a great provoker of three things.
What three things does drink especially provoke?
Marry, sir. Noose beating, sleep, and urine. Lechery, sir. It provokes and it unprovokes. It provokes the desire, but it takes away the performance. Therefore, much drink may be said to be an equivocator with lechery. It makes him and it mars him. It sets him on and it takes him off. It persuades him and disheartens him. Makes him stand to and not stand to. In conclusion, equivocates him in a sleep and, giving him the lie, leaves him.
I believe drink gave thee the lie last night.
That it did, sir. The very throat on me, but I requited him for his lie, and I think, being too strong for him, though he took up my legs some time, yet I made a shift to cast him.
Is thy master stirring? Our knocking has awaked him. Here he comes.
Good morrow, noble sir.
Good morrow, both.
Is the king stirring with thee, thane?
Not yet.
He did command me to call timely on him. I have almost slipped the hour.
I'll bring you to him.
I know this is a joyful trouble to you, but yet 'tis one.
The labor we delight in. Physic's pain. This is the door.
I'll make so bold to call, for 'tis my limited service.
Goes the king hence today?
He does. He did appoint so.
The night has been unruly. Where we slept, our chimneys were blown down. And as they say, lamentings heard of the air. Strange screams and prophecies.
Oh. Horror. Horror, horror. Tongue nor heart cannot conceive nor name thee.
Some did say the earth was feverous and did shake.
It was a rough night.
My young remembrance cannot parallel a fellow to it.
What's the matter?
Confusion now hath made his masterpiece. Most sacrilegious murder hath broke ope the Lord's anointed temple and stole thence the life of the building.
What is it you say?
The life? Mean you, his majesty?
Approach the chamber and destroy your sight with a new gorgon. Do not bid me speak. See and then speak yourselves. Awake! Awake! Ring the alarm bell! Murder and treason! Banquo and Donald Vane! Malcolm, awake! Shake off this downy sleep, death's counterfeit, and look on death itself. Up, up, and see the great dome's image. Blightwall, Malcolm, as from your graves, rise up and walk like sprites that countenance this horror. Ring the bell!
What's the business? That such a hideous trumpet calls to parley the sleepers of this house. Speak! Speak!
Oh, gentle lady, it is not for you to hear when I can speak. The repetition in a woman's ear would murder as it fell. Oh, Banquo. Banquo, our royal master is murdered.
What, in our house?
Too cruel anywhere. Dear Duff, I pretty contradict myself and say it is not so.
Had I but died an hour before this chance, I had lived a blessed time. For from this instant, there's nothing serious in mortality. All is but toys. Renown and grace is dead. The wine of life is drawn, and the mere lees is left this vault to brag of.
What's amiss?
You are, and do not know it. The spring, the head, the fountain of your blood is stopped. The very source of it is stopped.
Your royal father's murdered.
How? By whom? Those of his chamber, as it seemed, had done it. Their hands and faces were all badged with blood. So were their daggers, which, unwiped, we found upon their pillows. They stared and were distracted. No man's life was to be trusted with them.
Oh, yet I do repent me of my fury, that I did kill them.
Wherefore did you so?
Who can be wise, amazed, temperate, and furious, loyal, and neutral in a moment? No man! The expedition of my violent love outran the pause of reason. Here lay Duncan, his silver skin laced with his golden blood. And his gashed stabs looked like a breach in nature for ruin's wasteful entrance. There, the murderers, steeped in the colors of their trade, their daggers unmannerly breached with gore. Who could refrain that had a heart to love, and in that heart, courage to make love known?
Oh, help me hence.
Why do we hold our tongues that most may claim this argument for ours?
What should be spoken here, where our fate hid in an auger hole may rush and seize us? Let's away. Our tears are not yet brewed.
Nor our strong sorrow upon the fruit of emotion.
Look to the lady.
And when we have our naked frailties hid, that suffer in exposure, let us meet to question this most bloody piece of work to know it further. Fears and scruples shake us. In the great hand of God I stand, and fence against the undivulged pretense I fight of treasonous malice.
And so do I. So all.
Let us briefly put on manly readiness, and meet in the hall together.
Our clothing houses.
What will you do? Let's not consort with them. To show an unfelt sorrow is an office which the false man does easy. I'll to England.
To Ireland, aye. Our separated fortune shall keep us both the safer. Where we are as daggers in men's eyes. The nearer in blood, the nearer bloody.
Not that a sharpened shot will not get lighted, and our safest way is to avoid the egg, therefore the boss. And let us not be dainty of leave taking, but shift away. Let us warrant in that theft which steals itself when there's no mercy left.
How goes the world, sir, now?
Why, see you not?
It's known who did this more than bloody deed.
Those that Macbeth hath slain.
Last the day. What good could they pretend?
They were suborned. Malcolm and Donalbain, the king's two sons, are stolen away and fled, which puts upon them suspicion of the deed.
Against nature still. Thriftless ambition that would raven up thine own life's means. Then, 'tis most like the sovereignty will fall upon Macbeth.
He is already named and gone to Scone to be invested.
Where's Duncan's body?
Carried to Combkill, the sacred storehouse of his predecessors and guardian of their bones.
Were you to Scone?
No, cousin, I'll to Fife.
Well, I will thither.
Well, may you see things well done there. Adieu. Lest our old robes sit easier than our new.
It now. King, Coror, Glamis, all as the weird women promised. And I fear thou playedst most foully for it. Yet it was said it should not stand in thy posterity, but that myself should be the root and father of many kings. If there come truth from them, as upon thee, Macbeth, their speeches shine, why, by the verities on thee made good, may they not be my oracles as well, and set me up in hope.
He is our chief guest.
Had he been forgotten, it had been as a gap in our great feast, an all thing unbecoming.
Tonight we hold a solemn supper, sir, and I'll request your presence.
Let your highness command upon me. To the which my duties are with the most indissoluble tie forever knit.
Ride you this afternoon?
I'm a good lord.
We should have else desired your good advice, which still hath been both grave and prosperous in this day's council. But we'll take tomorrow. Is it far you ride?
As far, my lord, as will fill up the time twixt this and supper. Grow not my horse the better, I must become a borrower of the night for a dark hour or twain.
Fail not our feast.
My lord, I will not.
We hear our bloody cousins are bestowed in England and in Ireland, not confessing their cruel parasite, filling their hearers with strange invention. But of that tomorrow, when therewithal we shall have cause of state craving us jointly. Hie thee to horse. Till you return at night. Goes Fleance with you?
Aye, my good lord. Our time does call upon us.
I wish your horses swift and sure of foot, and so I do commend you to their backs. Farewell. Let every man be master of his time till 7 at night. To make society the sweeter welcome, we'll keep ourselves till supper time. Alone. Well then, God be with you. Sarah, a word with you. Attend those men our pleasure.
They are, my lord, without the palace gate.
Bring them before us.
To be thus is nothing but to be safely thus. Our fears in Banquo stick deep, and in his royalty of nature reigns that which would be feared. 'Tis much he dares, and to that dauntless temper of his mind he hath a wisdom that doth guide his valor to act in safety. There is none but he whose being I do fear, and under him my genius is rebuked, as it is said Mark Antony's was by Caesar. He chid the sisters when first they put the name of king upon me, and bade them speak to him. Then, prophet-like, they hailed him father to a line of kings. Upon my head they placed a fruitless crown and put a barren scepter in my grip, thence to be wrenched with an unlineal hand, no son of mine succeeding. If it be so, for Banquo's issue have I filed my mind. For them, the gracious Duncan, have I murdered, put rancors in the vessel of my peace, only for them. And mine eternal jewel given to the common enemy of man to make them kings, the seeds of Banquo kings. Rather than so, come fate into the list and champion me to the utterance.
Who's there? Now go to the door and stay there till we call.
Is Banquo gone from court?
Aye, madam, but returns again tonight.
Say to the king I would attend his leisure. For a few words.
Madam, I will.
How now, my lord? Why do you keep alone? Things without all remedy should be without regard. What's done is done.
We've scorched the snake, not killed it. She'll close and be herself, whilst our poor malice remains in danger of a former tooth. But let the frame of things disjoint, both the world suffer. Ere we will eat our meal in fear, and sleep in the affliction of these terrible dreams that shake us nightly. Better be with the dead, whom we to gain our peace have sent to peace, than on the torture of the mind to lie in restless ecstasy. In his grave. After life's fitful fever, he sleeps well. Treason has done his worst. Nor steel, nor poison, malice domestic, foreign levy, nothing can touch him further.
Come on. Gentle, my lord, sleek over your rugged looks. Be bright and jovial among your guests tonight.
So shall I, love. And so I pray be you. Let your remembrance apply to Banquo. Present him eminence, both of eye and tongue.
You must leave this.
Oh. Full of scorpions is my mind. Dear wife.
Thou know'st that Banquo in his fleance lives.
But in them nature's coffee's not a turn.
There's comfort yet. They are assailable.
What's to be done?
Be innocent of the knowledge, dearest Chuck, till thou applaud the deed. Come, sealing night, scarf up the tender eye of pitiful day, and with thy bloody and invisible hand cancel and tear to pieces that great bond which keeps me pale. Light thickens, and the crow makes wing to the rocky wood. Good things of day begin to droop and drowse, whilst night's black agents to their preys do rouse. Thou marvel'st at my words, but hold thee still. Things bad begun make strong themselves by ill. So prithee, go with me.
Join with us.
Macbeth.
He needs not our mistrust, since he delivers our offices and what we have to do.
Then stand with us.
Give us a light there! Ho! Oh. There will be rain tonight.
Let it come down!
Treachery!
Fly, good for you! Fly, fly, fly!
Your own degrees. Sit down. But first and last, a hearty welcome.
Thank you, Your Majesty.
Ourself will mingle with society and play the humble host. Our hostess keeps her state, but in best time we will require her welcome.
Pronounce it for me, sir, to all our friends. All my heart speaks, they are welcome.
See? They encounter thee with their hearts welcome. Both sides are even. Here I'll sit in the midst, be large in mirth. Anon will drink a measure the table round. Oh. There's blood upon my face.
Tis Banquo's, then.
Tis better thee without than he within. Is he dispatched?
My lord, his throat is cut. That I did for him.
Thou art the best of the cutthroats. Yet he's good that did the like for Fleance. If thou didst it, thou art the nonpareil.
Most royal sir, Fleance escaped.
Then comes my fit again. I had else been perfect, whole as the marble, founded as the rock, as broad and general as the casing air. But now I am cabined, cribbed, confined, bound in to saucy doubts and fears. But Banquo's safe.
Aye, my good lord. Safe in a ditch he bides,
with 20 trenchant gashes on his head. The least a death to nature.
Thanks for that. Get thee gone. Tomorrow we'll hear ourselves again.
My royal lord, you do not give the cheer. The feast is sold, that is not often vouched. While 'tis a making, 'tis given with welcome. To feast were best at home. From thence the sauce to meat is ceremony. Meeting were bare without it.
Sweet remembrancer. Now good digestion wait on appetite, and health on both.
May it please your highness. Sit.
Here had we now our country's honor roofed, were the graced person of our Banquo present. Who may I rather challenge for unkindness than pity for mischance?
Absence, sir, lays blame upon his promise. Please your highness to grace us with your royal company.
Well, the table's full.
Here is a place reserved, sir.
Where?
Here, my good lord.
Which of you have done this?
What, my good lord?
Thou canst not say I did it. Never shake thy glory locks at me!
Gentlemen, rise. His highness is not well.
Sit, worthy friends. My lord is often thus, and hath been from his youth. Pray you keep seat. The fit is momentary. Upon a thought, he will again be well. If much you note him, you shall offend him and extend his passion. Feed, and regard him not. Are you a man?
Aye, and a bold one, that dare look on that which might appall the devil.
Oh, proper stuff. This is the very painting of your fear. This is the air-drawn dagger which you said led you to Duncan. Oh, these flaws and starts, impostors to true fear, would well become a woman's story at a winter's fire, authorized by your grandam. Shame itself, why do you make such faces? When all's done, you look but on a stool.
Prithee, see, there, behold, look, lo, how say you? What care I if thou canst not speak too? And our graves must send those that we bury back. Our monument shall be the moors of kites.
Quite unmanned in folly.
If I stand here, I saw him.
Fie for shame.
The times has been that when the brains were out, the man would die, and there an end. But now they rise again with 20 mortal murders on their crowns and push us from our stools.
My worthy lord, your noble friends do lack you.
I do forget.
Do not muse at me, my most worthy friends. I have a strange infirmity which is nothing to those that know me. Come. Love and health to all. Then I'll sit down. Give me a drink. Feel full.
I drink to the general joy of the whole table, and to our dear friend, Banquo, whom we miss. Would he were here. To all and him we thirst, and all to all.
Our duties and the pledge.
Avaunt! Quit my sight! Let the earth hide me! My bones are marrowless. My blood is cold. Thou hast no speculation in those eyes which thou dost glare with!
Think of this, good peers, but as a thing of custom. 'Tis no other. Only it spoils the pleasure of the time.
What man dare? I dare. Approach thou like the rugged Russian bear, the armed rhinoceros, or the Hyrcan tiger. Take any shape but that, and my firm nerves shall never tremble, or be alive again. And dare me to the desert with thy sword. If trembling I inhabit, then protest me the baby of a girl. Hence, horrible shadow, unreal mockery. Hence! Why so? I am a man again. Pray you, sit still.
You have displaced the mirth, broke the good meeting with a most admired disorder.
Things be, and overcome us like a summer's cloud without our special wonder? You make me strange, even to the disposition that I owe, when now I think that you can behold such sights, and keep the natural ruby of your cheeks, when mine is blanched with fear.
What sights, my lord?
I pray you speak not. He grows
worse and worse. Question enrages him. At once, good night. Well, stand not upon the order of your going, but go at once!
Good night, and better health attend his majesty.
It will have blood. They say, blood will have blood. Stones have been known to move, and trees to speak. Augurs and understood relations have by maggot pies and chuffs and rooks brought forth the secrets man of blood. What is the night?
Almost at odds with the morning, which is which?
How sayest thou that Macduff denies his person at our great bidding?
Did you send to him, sir?
I hear it by the way. But I will send. There's not a one of them, but in his house I keep a servant feed. I will tomorrow, and betimes I will, to the weird sisters. More shall they speak. For now I am bent to know by the worst means. The worst. For mine own good, all causes shall give way. For I am in blood stepped in so far that should I wade no more, returning were as tedious as go o'er. Strange things I have in head, that will to hand, which must be acted, ere they may be scanned.
You lack the season of all natures. Sleep.
Come. Well to sleep. My strange and self-abuse is the initiate fear that wants hard use. We are yet but young indeed.
Thrice the brinded cat hath mewed.
Thrice and once the hedge pig whined.
Harpier cries. Tis time. Tis time.
Round about the cauldron go. In. The poisoned entrails. But under cold stone days and nights has 31. Poison venom, sleeping god. Boil thou first in the charmed pot. Double, double, toil and trouble. Fire burn and cauldron bubble.
Fill it of a finny snake. In the cauldron boil and bake. Eye of newt, toe of frog, wool of bat and tongue of dog. Adder's fork and blind worm's sting. Lizard's leg and howlet's wing. The charm of powerful trouble like a hell broth boil and bubble.
Wolf. Witch's mummy. Maw and gulf of the ravine salt sea shark. Lucifer lock. Digged in the dark. Liver of blaspheming Jew. Gall of goat. And slips of you. Slivered in the moon's eclipse. Nose of Turk and Tartar's lip. Oh. Finger of birth strangled babe, ditch delivered by a drab. Make the gruel thick and slab. Add hereto a tiger's chaudron. Oh, for the ingredients. Of our cauldron. Double, double, toil and trouble.
Fire burn and cauldron bubble.
Cool it with a baboon's blood. Then the charm is firm and good. By the pricking of my thumbs, something wicked this way comes. Open locks, whoever knocks.
How now, you secret black and midnight hags? What is it you do?
A deed without a name.
I conjure you. By that which you profess. However you come to know it, answer me. though you untie the winds and let them fight against the churches. Answer me to what I ask you.
Speak. Demand.
We'll answer.
See if I'd rather hear it from our mouths or from our masters.
Go on. Let me see.
Pour in the sow's blood that hath eaten her nine farrow. Grease that sweaten from the murderer's gibbet, throw into the flame. Come high or low,
thyself and office deftly show.
Tell me, thy unknown power.
He knows thy thought. Hear his speech, but say thou not.
Macbeth, Macbeth, Macbeth. Beware, Macduff. Beware the Thane of Fife. Dismiss me. Enough.
Here's another, more potent than the first.
Macbeth, Macbeth, Macbeth. Be bloody, bold, and resolute. Laugh to scorn the power of man, for none of woman born shall harm Macbeth. Be lion metal proud, and take no care who chafes, who frets, or where conspirers are. Macbeth shall never vanquished be, until great Birnam Wood to high Dunsinane Hill shall come against.
Seek to know no more.
I will be satisfied. Deny me this, and an eternal curse fall on you. Let me know!
Show!
Show! Show!
Show his eyes!
Breathe his heart! Come like shadows, so depart!
Thou art too like the spirit of Banquo. Down! Thy crown does sear mine eyelids, and thy hair, thou other gold-bound brow, is like the first. A third is like the former. Filthy hags, why do you show me this? A fourth, start eyes, what will the line stretch out to the crack of doom? Another yet, a seventh, I'll see no more. And yet the eighth appears, who bears a glass which shows me many more, and some I see the twofold balls and treble scepters carry. Horrible sight! Now I see 'tis true. For the blood-bolted Banquo smiles upon me and points at them for his. What? Is this so?
Aye, sir. All this is so. Why stands Macbeth thus amazedly? Come, sisters, cheer we up his sprites, and show the best of our delights, that this great king may truly say our duties did his welcome pay.
Where are they? Who was it came by?
'Tis 2 or 3, my lord. Bring you word Macduff has fled to England.
Fled to England?
Aye, my good lord.
Time, thou anticipates my dread exploits. The flighty purpose never is o'ertook unless the deed go with it. From this moment, the very firstlings of my heart shall be the firstlings of my hand. And even now, to crown my thoughts with axe, be thought and done. The castle of Macduff I will surprise.
seize upon Fife, give to the edge of the sword his wife, his babes, and all unfortunate souls that trace him in his line. No boasting like a fool. This deed I'll do before this purpose cool.
What has he done to make him fly the land?
You must have patience, madam.
He had none. His flight was madness. When our actions do not, our fears do make us traitors.
You know not whether it was his wisdom or his fear.
Wisdom? To leave his wife? To leave his babes, his mansion and his titles in the place from whence himself does fly? He loves us not. He wants the natural touch. For the poor wren, the most diminutive of birds, will fight her young ones in her nest against the owl. All is the fear and nothing is the love. As little is the wisdom when the flight so runs against all reason.
My dearest Cass, I pray you school yourself. But for your husband, he is noble, wise, judicious, and best knows the fits of the season. Speak much further. But cruel are the times when we are traitors and do not know ourselves. When we hold rumor from what we fear, yet know not what we fear, but float upon a wild and violent sea, each way and move. I take my leave of you. She'll not be long, but I'll be here again. Things at the worst will cease. Or else climb upward to what they were before. My pretty cousin. Blessing upon you.
Fathered he is, and yet he's fatherless.
And so much a fool should I stay longer. Would be my disgrace and your discomfort. I take my leave at once.
Was my father a traitor, Mother?
Aye, that he was.
What is a traitor?
Why, one that swears and lies.
And be it all traitors that do so?
Every one that does so is a traitor and must be hanged.
Must they all be hanged, swear and lie?
Everyone.
Who must hang them?
Why, the honest men.
Then the liars and swearers are fools. If there are liars and swearers enough to beat the honest men and hang up them.
Now God help thee, poor monkey. How wilt thou do for a father?
Bless you, fair dame. I am not to you known, though in your state of honour I am perfect. I doubt some danger does approach you nearly. If you will take a homely man's advice, be not found here. Hence with your little ones. Heaven preserve you, I dare abide no longer.
Whither should I fly? I have done no harm. I remember now. I'm in this earthly world, where to do harm is often laudable, to do good sometime accounted dangerous folly. Why then, alas, do I put up this womanly defense to say I have done no harm?
Is your husband?
I hope in no place so unsanctified where such as thou mayst find him.
Watched with you, but can perceive no truth in your report. When was it she last walked?
Since His Majesty went into the field, I have seen her rise from her bed, throw her nightgown upon her, unlock her closet, take forth paper, fold it, write upon it, read it, afterwards seal it, and again return to bed. All this while in a most fast sleep.
A great perturbation in nature. To receive at once the benefit of sleep and do the effects of watching. In this slumbery agitation, besides her walking and other actual performances, what at any time have you heard her say?
That, sir, which I will not report after her.
You may to me, and it is most meet you should.
Neither to you nor anyone, having no witness to confirm my speech. Now you. Here she comes. This is her very guise. And upon my life, fast asleep, observe her, stand close.
How came she by that light?
Why, it stood by her. She has it by her continually, 'tis her command.
You see, her eyes are open.
Why, but their sensor shut.
What is it she does now? Look how she rubs her hands.
It is an accustomed action with her to seem thus washing her hands. I have seen her continue in this a quarter of an hour.
Yet here's a spot.
She speaks. I will set down what comes from her to satisfy my remembrance to Orstro.
Out! Down, spot! Out, I say. It's murky. Fie, my lord, fie. A soldier and a feared. What need we fear and lose it, when none can call our power to account? Oh. Who would have thought the old man to have had so much blood in him?
Do you mark that?
What, will these hands ne'er be clean? No
more of that, my lord, no more of that. You are all with this starting.
Go to, you have known what you should not.
She has spoke what she should not, I am sure of that. Heaven knows what she has known.
Oh. Here's the smell of blood again. Oh, the perfumes of Arabia will not sweeten this little hand.
What a sigh is there.
I would not have such a heart in my bosom for the dignity of the whole body.
Well, well, well.
Pray God it be, sir.
Oh. Wash your hands. Put on your nightgown. Look not so pale. I tell you yet again, Banquo's buried, and he cannot come out on his grave.
Even so.
To bed. To bed.
Will she go now? To bed.
Directly.
Unnatural deeds to breed unnatural troubles. Infected minds to their death billows will discharge their secrets. Nor has she need of the divine and the physician. God. God forgive us all. Look after her. Good night.
Good night, good doctor.
Cousins, I hope the days are near at hand, the chambers will be safe.
We doubt it nothing.
What wood is this before us?
The wood of Burnham. Let every soldier hew him down a bough and bear it before him. Thereby shall we shadow the numbers of our host and make discovery ere in report of us.
It shall be done.
We learn no other but the confident tyrant keeps still in Dunsinane and will endure our setting down before it.
'Tis his main hope. For where there is advantage to be given, both more and less have given him the revolt. And none serve with him but constrained things whose hearts are absent too.
Let our just censors attend the true event and put we on industrious soldiership.
The time approaches that will with due decision make us know what we shall say we have and what we owe. Thoughts speculative, their unsure hopes relate. But certain issues, strokes must arbitrate.
Towards which, advance the war! Fly! All!
Till Burnham Wood remove to Dunsinane, I cannot take with fear. What's the boy Malcolm? Was he not born of woman? The spirits that know all mortal consequence have pronounced me thus. Fear not, Macbeth. No man that's born of woman shall e'er have power upon thee. Then fly, false thanes, and mingle with the English epicures. The mind I sway by and the heart I bear shall never sag with doubt nor shake with fear. Devil damn thee, Black. Thou cream-faced loon. Where got'st thou that goose look?
There is 10,000.
Geese, villain!
Soldiers, sir.
Go prick thy face and overread thy fear, thou lily-livered boy. What soldier's patch?
Death of thy soul. Those linen cheeks of thine counsel us to fear. What soldiers we face?
The English force, so please you.
Take thy face hence.
Seaton!
I am sick at heart when I behold.
Seaton, I say!
This push will cheer me ever, or deceit me now. I have lived long enough. My way of life has fallen into the sea, a yellow leaf. And that which should accompany old age is honor, love, obedience, troops of friends I must not look to have. But in their stead, curses, not loud, but deep, mouth honor, breath which the poor heart would fain deny and dare not.
Seaton!
What's your gracious pleasure?
What news more?
All is confirmed, my lord, which was reported.
I'll fight till from my bones my flesh be hacked. Give me mine armor.
It is not needed yet.
I'll put it on. Send out more horses, scour the country round, hang those that talk of fear. Give me mine armor.
How does thy patient, doctor?
Not so sick, my lord, as she is troubled with thick coming fancies that keep her from her rest.
Cure her of that. Canst thou not minister to her mind diseased? Pluck from the memory a rooted sorrow. Raise out the written troubles of the brain, and with some sweet oblivious antidote, cleanse the stuffed bosom of that perilous stuff which weighs upon the heart.
Therein the patient must minister to himself.
Throw physic to the dogs. I'll none of it.
Come, put mine armor on. Give me my staff. Seaton, send out.
Doctor, the thanes fly from me. Come, sir. Dispatch.
If thou couldst, doctor, cast the water of my land, find her disease, and purge it to a sound and pristine health, I would applaud thee to the very echo that should applaud again.
Put it off, I say.
What rhubarbs, senna, or what purgative drug would scour these English heads? Hearest thou of them? Aye, my good lord. Your royal preparation makes us hear something.
Bring it after me. I will not be afraid of death and bane till Burnham Forest come to Dunsinane.
Arrive. Dunsinane away and clear. Prophet again should hardly draw me here.
The only dog that's a full of water. Hail, friend!
The English power is near. Led on by Malcolm, his uncle Seward, and a good MacDuff. Revenge is burning them. For their dear causes wood to the bleeding and grim alarm excite a mortified man.
Near Burnham Wood shall we meet them. That way are they coming.
Who knows if Donald will be with his brother?
For certain, sir, he is not. I have a file of all the gentry. Seward's son is there, and many other unrough youths that even now protest their first of manhood.
What does a tyrant?
Great Dunsinane is strongly fortified. Some say he's mad. Others that lesser hate him do call it valiant fury. But for certain, he cannot buckle his distempered cause within the belt of rule.
Well, march we on to give obedience where 'tis truly owed. Mate we the medicine of a sickly wheel, and with him pour we in our country's purge each drop of us.
Or as much as it needs to dew the sovereign flower and drown the weeds. Make we our march toward Burnham.
March on.
Had all spent where our desire is got without content. It is safer to be that which we destroy than by destruction dwell in doubtful joy.
What is that noise?
It is the cry of women, my good lord.
I have almost forgot the taste of fears. The time has been my senses would have cooled to hear a night shriek. And my fell of hair, would it a dismal treatise rouse and stir as life were it? I have supped full with horrors.
Direness, familiar to my slaughterous thoughts, cannot once stop me.
Wherefore was that cry?
Queen, my lord is dead.
She should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word. Tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools away to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Life is but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury. Signifying nothing.
thou comest to use thy tongue. Thy story, quickly.
Gracious, my lord, I should report that which I say, so, but know not how to do it.
Well, say, sir.
As I distanned my watch upon the hill, I looked toward Burnin, and anon methought, the wood, but can't to move.
Liar and slave.
Let me endure your wrath, it be not so. Within this 3 mile, may you see it coming. I say, a moving grove.
If thou speak'st false, upon the next tree shall thou hang alive till famine cling thee. If thou speak sooth, I care not if thou dost for me as much. I pull in resolution and begin to doubt the equivocation of the fiend that lies like truth.
Fear not till Burnham Wood do come to Dunsinane. And now a wood comes towards Dunsinane. Arm! Arm! And out!
If this which he avouches does appear, there's nor flying hence, nor tarrying here.
I begin to be aweary of the sun, and wish the estate of the world were now undone.
Ring the alarm bell! Blow a wind! Come rack! At least we'll die with harness on our back.
Oh,
tied me to a stake. I cannot fly. Rebel, I must fight the course.
I was free that was not born of woman.
Such a one am I to fear, or none.
What is thy name?
Don't be afraid to hear it.
No, but thy call is thyself a hotter name than any in hell.
My name's Macbeth.
The devil himself could not pronounce a title more hateful to mine ear.
No, nor more fearful.
Thou liest, abhorred tyrant. With my sword, I'll prove the lie thou speak.
Thou wast born of woman. Swords I smile at, weapons love to scorn, brandished by a man that's of a woman born.
That's where the noise is. Tear and show thy face! If thou beest slain and with thou struck a vine, my wife and children's ghosts will hunt thee still. I cannot strike at wretched Cairns whose arms are higher to bear their stains. Either thou, Macbeth, or else my sword with an unbattered edge I sheath again unheeded.
There thou shouldst be, and this great clatter, one of greatest noise, seems bruited. Let me find him fortune, and more I beg in thought.
Castle's gently rendered. The tyrant's people on both sides do fight. The noble thanes do bravely in the war. The day almost itself professes yours. Little is to do.
We have met with foes that strike beside us.
Enter, sir, the castle.
Why should I play the Roman fool and die on mine own sword? For as I see lives, the gashes do better upon them.
Turn, hellhound. Turn.
Of all men else, have I avoided thee. But get thee back! My soul is charged enough with blood of thine already.
I have no words. My voice is in my sword. Thou bloodier villain than terms can give thee. Out!
Thou losest labor. As easy mayst thou the entrenchant air with thy keen sword impress as make me bleed. Let fall thy blade on vulnerable crests. I bear a charmed life, which must not yield to one of woman born.
Despair thy charm, and let the angel whom thou still hast served tell thee Macduff was from his mother's womb untimely ripped.
Accursed be the tongue that tells me so, for it hath cowed my better part of man. And be these juggling fiends no more believed that polter with us in a double sense, that keep the word of promise from our ear and break it to our hope. I will not fight thee.
Then yield thee, coward, and live to be the gaze and show of the time. We'll have thee as our rarer monsters are, painted upon a pole and under writ. Hear me, you see the tyrant.
I will not yield to kiss the ground before young Malcolm's feet and to be baited by the rabble's curse. Though Burnham Wood become to Dunsinane and thou opposed, being of no woman born, yet I will try the last. Before my body I lay my warlike shield. Lay on Macduff, and damned be him that first cries hold. Enough!
Thank you. Thank you.